Good morning, and welcome to worship with University United Methodist Church, Irvine, where all are welcome to belong, believe, and be love in this space. I welcome you whether this is your first week with us or whether you have been streaming ever since we have been worshiping together online. I invite you to make yourselves comfortable. Light a candle if you have one. Place your gifts and your tithes and your offerings out to be blessed during the prayer, or even donate online while we are gathered together. And let us prepare our hearts and minds for this service where Melissa Thatch will be bringing us our sermon. Let us worship God.
Please join me in our call to worship. The Lord our God is rich in mercy and generous in grace. May we be those who receive these gifts with gratitude. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ calls us to change our hearts and lives. May we change our hearts from entitlement and greed to humility and compassion, and may our lives reflect God's love abundantly. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
All creatures of the God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him, hallelujah. Oh, brother sun with golden beam. Oh, sister moon with silver gleam.
Of Hey everybody, I'll be filling in for Captain Nate today. What a beautiful day it is outside, if I do say so myself.
Oh, hey Argyle, what a beautiful day.
That's what I was saying, Sally. How are you today?
Oh, I'm great, thanks. Although,
Well, what's the matter?
Well, it's a beautiful day and all, but I was walking here and I saw somebody dumped a bunch of trash just in the area by the trash can, and it didn't go into the trash can.
Oh, that is kind of sad.
Yeah, I mean, we all share this beautiful place. It's kind of for all of us, so, I mean, we really all should take care of it.
Well, that's right, Sally, you're absolutely right. That's why we recycle.
Recycle?
Yeah, there are certain things that you can throw in the trash because it's garbage. And there are certain things that you can compost, and that, like coffee grounds and banana peels. And then some things like soda cans and bottles, those can be recycled and turned into new things again.
Oh, I didn't know that. Neat.
If we don't take care of what we have, we won't have it for very long. And by not putting our trash away in the right places, just throwing it around, it can really hurt everything for everybody.
Oh, you mean like how garbage can sometimes get into the ocean and hurt the fish?
Well, yeah, but it doesn't just have to be the ocean. Sometimes a plastic bag might blow into an animal's environment, and all of a sudden they can't live there anymore. Imagine if a bunch of garbage went into your home. You wouldn't want to live there, would you?
Oh, I guess not.
That's why we have to take care of what we have. And God has entrusted this planet to us. We're its keepers. We need to make sure that it's clean and we're not making messes on it, so that when the people who live on it after us have it, they get an opportunity to enjoy the beauty of God's creation too.
Well, that's a great way to look at it. Thanks, Argyle.
You bet. Hey, kids, will you say a quick prayer with us? Dear God, thank you for giving us this beautiful world to experience.
And thank you for giving us the means to take care of it.
It's not always easy.
But with your help, we can make sure it's a beautiful place for us
and for those who come after us. Amen. Okay. Bye, kids. Everybody have a good week. Bye.
Bye.
And now let us be in a spirit of prayer. And in honor of our Earth Month and in honor of the native people who were here long before we came, this morning's prayer is a Native American prayer, a Chippewa prayer, that is found in our United Methodist Book of Worship. O God, creator of all that is and ruler of the universe, we pray that someday an arrow will be broken, not in something or someone, but by each of humankind, to indicate peace, not violence. Someday, oneness with creation rather than domination over creation, will be the goal to be respected. Someday, fearlessness to love and make a difference will be experienced by all people. Then the eagle will carry our prayer for peace and love, and the people of red, white, yellow, brown, and black communities can sit in the same circle together to communicate in love and experience the presence of your great mystery in their midst. Someday can be today. We pray this day for healing for those in our University UMC family, for Bonnie Wright, Margie Wakeham, Ann Ownby, Laverna Price, Barbara Albers, and Lois McKissick. And we pray for those who grieve. We lift up especially the Reyes family and the family of Dick Coles. We pray for those who have been homebound long before the stay-at-home order, for Muriel and for Jan. And we give you thanks and praise for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. And we give back to you from the first fruits of our labor, the first fruits of the harvest of our lives, as a sign of our trust and faith in you, O Lord. And we join together in unison, even while we are scattered throughout the community, as we say the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, Chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. Listen now for the word of God. There was a certain rich man who clothed himself in purple and fine linen, and who feasted luxuriously every day. At his gate lay a certain poor man named Lazarus, who was covered with sores. Lazarus longed to eat the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Instead, dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried by angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. While being tormented in the place of the dead, he looked up and saw Abraham at a distance with Lazarus by his side. He shouted, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I'm suffering in this flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime, you received good things, whereas Lazarus received terrible things. Now Lazarus is being comforted, and you are in great pain. Moreover, a great crevasse has been fixed between us and you. Those who wish to cross over from here to you cannot. Neither can anyone cross from there to us." The rich man said, "Well, then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house. I have five brothers. He needs to warn them so that they don't come to this place of agony." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They must listen to them." The rich man said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will change their hearts and lives." Abraham said, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, then neither will they be persuaded if someone rises from the dead. Let the church hear what the Spirit is saying. Thanks be to God.
Creator, thank you for the land and water and all you have given to us to care for and all of the creatures that inhabit this place. Help us in these moments to hear what you would say to us. Amen. Good morning. I want to begin by acknowledging the Tongve or Keech people who tended this land for generations before they were enslaved by colonists. I thank them for the way they honored and cared for this land we live on, and I grieve the way they were treated. And although they are still here, are still not recognized as a tribe. This is not a passage I would have chosen. I tend to stay away from the hell conversation because of childhood trauma surrounding movies about the end of the world. So when I was reading A Hopeful Earth and Pastor Kathy asked me for a sermon title, I said Highway to Hell because when I'm uncomfortable, I make jokes. I considered asking Mr. Carpenter to do an arrangement of that AC/DC song, but I didn't think the choir would go for it. See, I made another joke. Seriously, though, I am glad I've had the opportunity to sit with this passage for the past couple weeks and share some of the things I've been thinking about. And I apologize if seeing that title come up in Constant Contact made you nervous about Pastor Kathy letting me preach. So let's all take a deep breath and relax our shoulders. In the first sentence of this passage, Luke is setting us up to remember that the upside-down kingdom is one where the rich man is nameless and the marginalized person of Lazarus is seen and known. Those of us in the Bible in a Year class know that this is a theme that runs throughout Luke's gospel. Jesus talks about money and the poor and turns everything upside down to illustrate that what he is about is different than what they're used to. It says, the rich man was clothed in purple linen and feasted luxuriously every day. Does he remind anyone else of Henry VIII? Because that's the mental image I got when I read this, was Henry VIII, who was known for his extravagant lifestyle and turnover rate of wives. When it talks about Lazarus hoping to get scraps from the rich man's table, that's not hyperbole. It was his reality. In A Hopeful Earth, the authors write that this was before the age of napkins, when the rich would use bread to wipe their hands after a meal and throw it to the ground. But Lazarus was not even afforded that paternalistic gesture. Instead, his wounds were licked by dogs. Both Lazarus and the rich man die, and while Lazarus is carried by angels to Abraham's side, the rich man is buried and goes to the place of the dead. The scripture says the rich man is tormented, and he sees Lazarus at Abraham's side. He asks Father Abraham to send Lazarus to him to cool his tongue. And this is the first time in the story that we know that the rich man knows Lazarus's name. Reading that, I wonder how he knew him, if he had noticed Lazarus at his gate and just ignored him. The rich man lived a life of luxury, consuming and throwing away without a thought for the person who was right in front of him. Lazarus wasn't even a blip on his radar until he saw what Lazarus could do for him. To me, this transactional way of thinking toward other human beings is the most helpful definition of sin. Like Henry VIII throwing away wives who displeased him, the rich man ignoring Lazarus until Lazarus had what he wanted is the very opposite of our Creator's vision for us.
Lazarus lived in the waste of other people, a kind of hell on earth. And the people who passed by him probably thought, that has nothing to do with me. I think that's one of the greatest temptations we have as humans. The idea that when someone is hurt or a system is oppressing someone, that it has nothing to do with us, that is not our responsibility. First, I want to say that we are all guilty of that way of thinking, so this is not a judgment. There are plenty of times when I ignore things or people I don't want to deal with. Of course, I try to be a good person. I feel like we all do, for the most part. We're trying to be good people, and we want good things for everyone. But wanting good things for everyone and being willing to change behaviors and practices to make that a reality are two very different things. I'm challenging myself to consider both how I am contributing to the problem and what steps I need to take to contribute to the solutions. And I say solutions because I don't think there's just one solution. When we moved from Hawaii to California, I vowed to live a simpler life when we got here. Mostly that was a reaction to having to box up all our belongings and ship them across the ocean. I gave away a lot of stuff and told Chris, no more stuff. These children have enough toys. We have enough X, Y, and Z. We don't need any more. But when we moved from our apartment to my in-laws' house back in November, do you know what I discovered? We had accumulated even more stuff. And we've only been here at that point 2 years. It's maddening. Clutter makes me feel crazy, and looking at our clutter every day during a pandemic, well, I rage cleaned a lot. And that is where you clean, but you're very unhappy about it. I have not been everywhere in the world, but I have been enough places to know that this love of stuff is not a universal thing. I feel like it's particular to where we live. The way we buy and consume and throw away with little to no thought of how our stuff is made or where our trash ends up is the result of an individualist mindset that doesn't see the connection between our choices and the world around us. But these choices are harming the land that we live on, the oceans, all aspects of the natural world. And it's also hurting our fellow human beings. In an interview at Calvin University, Dr. William Jennings said, "Christians confess a doctrine of creation. I don't think we actually function inside a doctrine of creation. For many centuries, we have been taught to think of our bodies as separate from the earth, and the result of that is a vision of creation that really doesn't take into account our connectedness, our relationality to the world." He goes on to say that this disconnection from land and place and viewing the land as private property has not only impacted the natural world, but also our relationship to one another. It's interesting to me that the two things mentioned about the rich man are his clothing and his taste in food. It's interesting because in this journey that I've been on over the past year to examine my complicity in systems that oppress people, fashion was one of the first changes I made. I saw something I couldn't ignore and knew I had to make a change. Acknowledging the mistreatment of the people who make my clothes was the first step on my journey. This past week, we celebrated Earth Day, and it was also Fashion Revolution Week, something that was started in response to the factory collapse in Bangladesh in 2013 that killed 1,138 people and injured more than 2,000 others. The day before the collapse, the managers had been told by an inspector that the building was not safe. But needing to keep up with the demand of the fast fashion industry, of which we are the greatest consumers, they demanded everyone come to work. While that is certainly the worst tragedy in recent years, it is far from the only one like it. On top of that, the majority, something like 98% of garment workers, are not paid a living wage. 98% of the people who make our clothes. Fast fashion abuses the makers of our clothing and is harming the world through overconsumption of water and materials. We hear the phrase, they just don't make them like they used to, but what have we stopped to consider why? Things aren't made to last anymore because that doesn't drive profits. Clothes and shoes and electronics that are made to replace every few months or to keep up with a trend is all part of a system driving us to spend and consume with little to no thought for the people in the most vulnerable places in the world who suffer the consequences of our consumption. But that is just one example of the way our lifestyle of consumption is affecting the world. The other, like the rich man, is our love of luxurious foods. Y'all, I love a good steak. And when several of my friends became vegan in the past decade, I avoided the documentaries they recommended because, quite frankly, I didn't want to think about it. I did not need one more thing to care about. That was what I actually said to somebody 6 months ago. I don't need to care about anything else because I already care about a lot of things. I would have continued on this path of willful ignorance were it not for needing an earth-related film for our faith and film discussion this month. I watched one documentary that set me on a path of research to determine if what I had just seen was accurate. And as much as I hate to say it, it was. The scientific data points to the mass production of meat as one of the greatest contributors to climate change. I decided to try a vegan diet for 2 weeks, just as an experiment, to see what was doable for our family. I did it, and I ate ribs yesterday. But we have decided to move to a mostly plant-based diet, because luxurious food is no longer an everyday thing in our house. To be honest, if it were not for the fact that climate change is creating more and more refugees all over the world, it would be easy for me to absorb the information I saw in that documentary and walk away and not change anything. But knowing that a very simple change in our life could help the land that we live on and the people who suffer the most from our choices, I can't not care about it now. I want to be very clear. I'm not saying that you have to shop only fair trade businesses or stop eating meat in order to be a faithful follower of Christ. I'm not telling you what I think you should do at all. I'm inviting you to see the Lazarus at your gate. I'm inviting you to consider the changes you could make to your habits of consumption, to consider what Wesley's do no harm may mean in your life. Maybe it's cutting back on meat. Maybe it's finding ways to reuse and repurpose the clothing and items you already have. Maybe it's rethinking the gifts you give so as not to fill someone else's home with stuff. Or shopping more thoughtfully from companies who pay their workers a living wage and use more ethical practices with regard to sustainability. Maybe it's planting a garden and growing some vegetables or herbs to share with your neighbors. This invitation is not easy. It is also something, complete transparency, we have a long way to go in our family. There are lots of things that I wish that we did better, but because of convenience, right now we don't. But I think it's always a good thing when we consider the ways that our actions affect other people, the ones that we see and choose to ignore, and the ones that we haven't seen before this moment. Whatever changes you feel drawn to consider, I believe they'll make you more aware of the world around you and remind you of your connectedness to your fellow humans and to this land that we live on. Thank you.
How does the creature say life?
I invite you to stay for the postlude and watch the announcement slides that will scroll for the many ways that you can be connected and be active in ministry, to be Christ's hands and feet in this place. So I do invite you to come to coffee hour. And I also want to let you know that next Sunday, May 2nd, is a communion Sunday, but it's also our next outdoor worship opportunity. So please, reservations are required, and we would like for all reservations to be made by Thursday so we can prepare the spaces for everybody. But please go to the Constant Contact or contact the church office and register to participate in our in-person worship on the lawn or from your car next week. We will also have in-person worship again on May 23rd and again on June 13th. Now this week, our Sisters Book Club will meet on Tuesday at 7:30 via Zoom. If you do not have that link already, please reach out to Linda Dressler as she can give it to you. And the book that they will be discussing this month is The Girl They Left Behind. Now, because it is Sisters Book Club, our Tuesday evening Bible study will be meeting at 4 o'clock. So if you are part of that class or maybe the Wednesday class and you want to participate on Tuesday this week, please join us at 4 o'clock. The link is in Constant Contact. And finally, our award, the Spirit of Volunteerism Award that is being offered by Families Forward for University UMC will be honored at the 1OC Spirit of Volunteerism Awards this Thursday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And it's a 90-minute program. It's from 1 until 2:30, and it's free. So I invite you to go to the link in Constant Contact and check that out as well. There are so many ways to be in ministry together. We are bonded in love even as we are worshiping apart from one another. So please get involved. Thank you so much.
And now, Creator, send us out to the world you love with eyes to see the ways we can live toward a hopeful earth. Amen.